Welcome back, everybody. This is for Little Lily Princess. Based on the dramatic, intense music, I think something bad's about to happen. Lavinia strode through the halls, Tybalt clasped in her bosom, crooning little songs to him and paying no attention to any of the fur he might shed onto her dress. He's been carrying that cat around all day. Gossiping about your betters, Ermengarde? You had better be careful. Bad little birds who squawk and squeal get gobbled up whole. Lavinia threw her head back and laughed. Because again, she needs that Ojo-sama laugh. Tybalt stirred in her grass, yelling faintly. Shh, shh, my prince. Yes, you're a good kitty. Shh. That's what cats do, you know. They eat the weak. The sound of her humming marked her passage as she moved out of sight. What the hell would anyone want to go for Lavinia's heart? She's such a bitch. I think she set that cat on the birds on purpose. I'm sure she wouldn't do that. You heard what she said. She was laughing at me. No, that doesn't mean she... No, I won't believe it. She said what she said to taunt you, and that was very unkind of her, but she isn't a wicked person, not really. It would be so wrong of her to accuse of something so dreadful. You were too charitable. Lavinia is horrid. I know you're always kind, and I'm glad that you are, but she doesn't deserve it. It isn't so much about what she deserves. Kindness isn't something you should have to earn. A princess should always be kind, whether it's to a noble or to a peasant or a witch. Sometimes being kind to a wicked witch is the only way to break her spell, or to make a friend. I wish Lavinia would be kind to others. So do I. Indeed, so do I. Because Lavinia's kind of a bitch. Yeah, just taking a quick look through my stats, looking through what can stand to go up. Let's do two tutoring sessions, why not? Darn, I did not get any belief this time. Sarah, may I come in? Of course. This may be a foolish question, but... Do you know where Lavinia has gone? Is she not in her room? No. Then I don't know where she is. Perhaps she went out to have an ice. I take it that means ice cream? I don't know. She must have gone out somewhere, but she didn't tell me where she was going. I feel like in the past weeks she's spoken to more to Tybalt than to me. She's obsessed with that cat. She's even taken it into her room to sleep with it. I'm supposed to be her best friend, and... Jessie looked down, hugging her arms around herself. Sometimes when you're feeling sad, it's easier to talk to someone who can't talk back. Someone who'll just listen. She looked over the doll displayed in a pride of place. Emily is a very good listener. You think Lavinia has troubles she isn't telling me about? I don't know. You know her better than I do. I would turn myself into a cat if I could, if that would make her happy. It usually doesn't go well in stories when a princess is turned into a cat. That means she's under a curse. Oh, I'm no princess. You could be. If you wanted to, anyone could be a princess if they're willing to work hard at it. That's only pretend. I think princesses who live in castles are kind of pretend too, because we want to pretend they're different than we are, just because of where they were born. You are a queer sort of girl sometimes, Sarah Crewe. Maybe you're the one who was born different. Oh, week 20. I could talk to someone else. I could talk to one of the other girls here. Because I can't talk to Becky yet. Until week 23, really. Why not? Let's talk to Ermengarde. Sarah and Ermengarde walked through the halls of Miss Minchin's together hand in hand. Dancing lessons. She sighed noisily, her shoulders rising and falling. I wish that being hopeless at books meant I was good at something else instead. My father wouldn't be happy if I were only good at dancing, but at least Miss Minchin wouldn't look at me so disapprovingly. But it's only something else for me to fail at. I feel so heavy and graceless compared to the other girls. She is heavier than the other girls, but she isn't graceless. I think you move very well. You're always in time to the music. Lavinia isn't. But I don't look right when I move my arms, and the dance master always frowns at me. Jessie is the best of us. She looks like a flower in the breeze, like a gloriosa lily, because its petals are long and red and wavy like her hair. They tell us we should try and move like the field of Caladines. I never felt like a Caladine. Or Celadine. I don't know. Celadine? Celadon? I know what a Celadine looks like, but I'm not one. They reached Sarah's room and took seats upon the bed. What is that? I don't think we had them in India. Oh, a little yellow flower that's the lesser Celadine. I really don't know, really. If it's a hard or a soft C. They're not very tall, but the flowers are very bright with lots of yellow petals like this. She held up her hands, curling her fingers around. They come up early in the spring. They grow in great bunches in the woods. All over the ground, mostly the leaves, but with little bright dots of flowers. The other kind is taller. The flowers are yellow, too bright. Yellow, too bright. Oh, right, are yellow too, bright yellow, but they only have four petals. You may have seen those, I'm not sure. What flowers grow wild in India? Oh, many kinds. Tall spikes covered with purple orchards that nod down. Flowers with petals pink as lips that grow straight up from the ground with no stems. I don't know all the names. I wish you could have brought some with you. If I had picked flowers in India before I left, they would have died and fallen apart on the ship. Ermengarde hung her head. I'm sorry, it was a stupid idea. No, I wish I could have brought you flowers to see as well. Perhaps someday I will learn to draw and paint with watercolors. Then I could make pictures of flowers so I could bring them to show you. Can you draw? I don't know. She held out her hands in front of her, examining the stubby fingers and their short, blunt nails. I wouldn't expect that. I can. Your hands are so delicate, Sarah. That's the way a lady's hands should be. Sarah pressed her palm against Ermengarde's. Her fingers seemed almost the same length, but more narrow. Well, Emily's fingers are much rounder and shorter than yours, and she's still a lady. Your hands are stronger than mine. I'm sure there are many things your hands can do that mine can't. But you can do everything. Sarah's eyes on him. took on a mischievous glint. Only magic can do everything. Imagine what I could do with the school if I really could do everything. New week. Bum, 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 bum. Sorry. The sound of angry voices drew Sarah into the hall. You've been touching my things, haven't you?
No, miss, I haven't.
Didn't you clean my rooms?
Yes, miss.
Then you touched my belongings, didn't you?
No, please, your pardon, miss, I didn't.
Let her be. Sarah found herself feeling quite cross with Lavinia. Lavinia's moods had been mercurial for some time, but to take them out on Becky, who could not defend herself, that was too much. Of course she's been in your rooms to clean them. She may have moved something to dust it. That's not doing anything wrong. You have no reason to scold her.
No reason? No reason? If she moves my books so that I cannot find them and knocks them off my tables and puts her filthy fingers on my underclothes.
The impertinence of it, as if she had any right to handle a young lady's possessions.
Please, miss, I'm sorry.
Lavinia's eyes were on Sarah now. Perhaps you're the reason she can't keep her hands to herself. Don't think I haven't noticed.
Noticed what?
That girl spending extra time in your rooms. What have you been teaching her there, hidden away, telling stories again? What would Miss Minchin think of that?
I've given Becky extra duties.
It wasn't entirely a falsehood, Sarah told herself. She had requested that Becky stay and speak with her, and request from a student was something like a duty for a servant.
If you told Miss Minchin, she'd wonder why you were interfering.
You already have a personal maid. Is every servant in the school meant to be at your beck and call?
There are many things I need done, and none of your concern.
You think you're very special, don't you? You might have a surprise coming for you yet.
Lavinia whirled a bat, passing through a door in a room, slamming it behind her with much force.
Oh, miss, I didn't mean to cause.
You didn't cause anything, Becky. Whatever's wrong with Lavinia isn't your fault.
Yeah, she just had too much Carnation Instant Bitch for breakfast.
I do not like Lavinia. She's a horrible person. Even if she's just kind of petty and jealous that Sarah kind of took the lead over her, it's still no real reason to do so. To be that way.
Alright. Probably gonna need to boost our stats back up some more now that we had some of these scenes go on. Brightness dance. Very nice.
Where is that girl? Where is she?
Lavinia, what are you doing?
Where is your little pet, Sarah? Look what she's done now.
Lavinia held up a pair of shredded stockings.
Ruined. Completely ruined. Where is that girl? She ought to be whipped. I'll have her.
You will not.
What did you say?
She is pissed.
You've been letting Tybalt sleep in your rooms. He got it at your stockings, not Becky. That's a claw mark. And you can't blame him either, because he's just a cat, and that's what cats do.
You stupid, fat-faced fool!
Girls!
Lavinia's enraged tones had attracted extra attention. Lavinia, I'm surprised at you, shrieking and carry on like a fishwife. What a way to behave! You ought to follow Sarah's example. Sarah is always a model student. You could learn a great deal from her.
Damn straight. Lavinia's head jerked as if she'd been struck a blow. The ruined stockings drifted, forgotten from her nup hands.
Yes, Miss Minchin.
Well, that was brief, actually. Too bad, I kind of want to talk to Lavinia. As much as I hate her, I kind of want to talk to her. But you know what? We're just going to skip the weekend. Another new week. We're just blazing through this now. As little Lottie walked past the classroom, which should be, by any rights, empty at such a time, she heard a most curious sound.
Huh?
The noise was faint enough that most ears might have overlooked it, but even in its quietness, it was a sound which Lottie was intimately familiar. It was the sound of a girl crying. And so it was that Lottie, who had never before known for her sympathy, padded into the classroom and found seated on the floor with her arms hugging her knees and her eyes streaming with tears, Lavinia Herbert.
What's the matter?
Go away. Lottie enjoyed herself being fussed over far too much to imagine that anyone else might truly mean it when she demanded to be left alone. How cute. Lottie came closer, laid her plump little hands on Lavinia's shoulder, petting the older girl as teachers had petted her.
There, there.
Don't touch me! Ow. She lashed out arm and elbow, striking the smaller child full force, knocking her away.
Ah!
I promised I wouldn't do that. Caught off balance, Lottie twisted and fell hard upon her knees, skidding slightly on the floor as she landed. Okay, I promise I'm not gonna do that. I'll spare your poor ears. Lavinia's tears had been quiet. Lottie's were anything but. Sarah was at the time in another room, entirely curled up in a window seat, enjoying a recently acquired book. Between one word and another, her concentration was disrupted by the sound of a distant howling. For all the stories she told of heaven, Sarah would be the first to admit that she herself was not an angel. She felt obliged to leave her book and look after her adopted child, but was not pleased about it. Thus, when she stomped into the classroom and found Lottie on the ground, nursing her redded knee, Lavinia standing over her, Sarah felt herself quite snappish and unreasonable.
Stop this minute, you crybaby! Stop this minute!
I'm not a crybaby! I'm not! You are!
You nasty little spoiled thing! I should like to slap you!
Sarah! Sarah whirled on Lavinia, who appeared to be the root cause of the disruption of her reading, whose face was now quite dry.
Well, I would like to slap you.
Immediately ashamed, she struggled to restrain herself. But I don't want to slap you.
No, I don't want to slap you. I should like to slap you, but I won't. We're not little gutter children. We are both old enough to know better.
Ah, yes, Your Royal Highness. We are princesses, I believe. At least one of us is. It stunned more bitterly than either of them could have expected. For Sarah to hear her beloved fancy mocked in such a tone, she felt blood rush up to her face and tingle in her ears. But she stopped herself. A princess did not fly into rages.
Excuse me.
It's true. Sometimes I do pretend I am a princess. I pretend I am a princess so that I can try and behave like one.
Damn me, how grand! I hope when you ascend the throne, you won't forget us.
I won't.
Huh? You think you're the only one who's special? You're wrong. Just you wait, Sarah Crewe. You'll see.
Lavinia left the room, her neck stiff, her head high.
Sarah, Mama, she...
Hush, hush, Lottie. It's all right. Never mind. Come and sit with the in the window seat with me, and I'll whisper a story to you.
Will you? Will you tell me about the diamond mines again?
Of course.
Oh,
Sarah's such a good little mother. I will just practice dance. Tutor, I guess. Everything else is pretty okay. We'll just, I guess, kind of alternate between dance, which will give us grace. Okay, that was worthless. Okay, we got at least one grace here. Oh, excellent. Mademoiselle, there's a letter for you. Oh, another letter from Papa. It does not seem long at all since his last letter. A longer wait might make me feel quite lonely and neglected, or risk him fading from my thoughts, but this is just right. I wonder if he's explored the diamond caves yet. My dear little missus. The letter did not seem to be written in such boyish high spirits as usual. He was not very well, and was evidently overweighted by the business connected with the diamond mines. You see, little Sarah, your daddy's not a businessman at all, and figures, documents bother him. He does not really understand them. All this seems so enormous. It gives me a splitting headache, even to consider these matters. Perhaps I'm the one who should be away at school again, learning how to manage things. Ah, and if I was not feverish, I should not be awake, though, for one half of each night tossing about, spending the other half in troublesome dreams. If my little missus were here, I dare say she'd give me a solemn good advice and put my mind at ease. What wouldn't I give to have your little arms around my neck this minute? God grants that these matters be soon resolved, and grant me leave to return to England for a visit. A visit? Oh, Mary, yes, my papa may be coming for a visit. Are you sure, mademoiselle? It is a long way to travel. I do not wish you to be disappointed. Well, he doesn't promise that he can, but he does say he would like to. She read a little further along. He's also asking about what I want for my birthday. Oh, boy. Sorry, I remember the story enough to know that it's after her birthday that she loses everything, basically. Wouldn't it be lovely if my papa were here for my birthday? Oui, my... I really wish I could read French now. It's so classy. I know, I mustn't fasten my hopes on it, but it is a beautiful thing to believe. She looked down at the letter and smiled. Papa is asking if a doll will be an acceptable present. I told him I didn't want a lot of dolls, but he said a special doll might be a companion for Emily while I'm busy with classes. That is a pretty thought. Yes, she must be a very special doll. You see, I'm getting very old, and by the time of my next birthday, I do not think I should be given dolls anymore. This will be my last doll. There's something solemn about that, don't you think? Of course, mademoiselle. If I could write poetry, I am sure a poem about a last doll would be very nice. But I cannot write poetry. I've tried it, and it made me laugh. It did not sound like Watts or Coleridge, or Shakespeare at all. Perhaps when you are completely too old for dolls, you'll have more of a talent for poetry in exchange. Do you think it could work that way? I never know how I will change, even though I am very different every day. Sarah set her letter aside and knelt to address Emily. I should respect the last doll very much, but nothing could ever take your place. I hope you do not become jealous of each other and can be very good friends. I am sure they will. Alright, this is a good port. This is a good point to call it quits. Thanks for joining me on this particular episode, guys. I will see you in the next part.